want to talk about meaning making and mutual regulation. And the essential point and framework that I want to establish is really two simple but I think really critical things when we try to think about infants and their development and what makes for normal or aberrant development. The first is that infants, even newborns, make meaning about the world. That's what they're about. It may not be the kind of meanings we make about the world, but they're always making meanings, and developmentally, those meanings change. But everyone here in this room is continuously making meanings about what's going on. Hopefully good meanings about me, hopefully good meanings when we finish, but meanings are being made. And that when I'm working with children, or I'm working with adults, or I'm working with newborn infants, what I'm always trying to do is figure out what kind of sense they're making out of the world and what it is that they're dealing with. It's always the question I ask. And so I spent sort of 40 years trying to put my feet into the shoes of an infant and trying to understand how they function in the world. And of course, I had one of the greatest teachers in the world and mentors and friends in the form of Barry Brazelton, who still just amazes me with the things that he knows and points out. And I've tried to steal everything I possibly can from him. So I've been trying to put myself into the shoes of the infant. Most of my colleagues think I'm pretty infantile, so I guess I've succeeded. And the other thing is about mutual regulation, that it's a process, that the meaning-making process is a mutual process, that it has to do with social engagement. It's not the only way infants make meaning, but it's probably the most critical way that infants make meaning. So I'm going to show you a little videotape, because you'll get the major points out of this. Unlike the Red Sox, I thought I really hit a home run here. The good, the bad, and the ugly. All of you know this film and the theme of it. But what it talks about is the nature of caretaking and the kinds of effects that we have on children, from the typically good, which is not without its problems, to the bad, which we all experience, but hopefully isn't too toxic, and the ugly, which is kind of something that's toxic and chronic and reiterated. And the idea is how these affect the infant, how they affect the meaning-making that the infant engages in. So this will be a couple of minutes of a really brief lecture, but hopefully it gets across the point, and it'll also give you your first introduction to the still face. And let me add, if for some reason you might want a copy of this, if you send me, it's on YouTube, I don't know exactly how it got there, but if you want, if you email me, I'll more than happily send you the video, because I think it can be useful for teaching purposes. So.
Babies this young are extremely responsive to the emotions and the reactivity and the social interaction that they get from the world around them. This is something that we started studying 30, 40 years ago, when people didn't think that infants could engage in social interaction. In the still face experiment, what the mother did was she sits down and she's playing with her baby, who's about a year of age.
I'm like a girl. Oh.
And she gives a greeting to the baby. The baby gives a greeting back to her.
Yeah.
This baby starts pointing at different places in the world, and the mother's trying to engage her and play with her. They're working to coordinate their emotions and their intentions, what they want to do in the world. And that's really what the baby is used to. And then we ask the mother to not respond to the baby. The baby very quickly picks up on this, and then she uses all of her abilities to try and get the mother back. She smiles at the mother. She points because she's used to the mother looking where she points.
Yeah.
The baby puts both hands up in front of her and says, "What's happening here?" She makes that screechy sound at the mother, like, "Come on, why aren't we doing this?" Even in this 2 minutes, when they don't get the normal reaction, they react with negative emotions, they turn away, they feel the stress of it, they actually may lose control of their posture because of the stress that they're experiencing.
Okay. I'm here. And what are you doing? Oh, yes. Oh, what a big girl.
It's a little like the good, the bad, and the ugly. The good is that normal stuff that goes on, that we all do with our kids. The bad is when something bad happens, but the infant can overcome it. After all, when you stop the still face, the mother and the baby start to play again. The ugly is when you don't give the child any chance to get back to the good. There's no reparation, and they're stuck in that really ugly situation.
You'll notice the really technical term about doing what we do with babies and whatever. That's what I've been studying. Maybe someone has a reaction to it if they've not seen it, or
so sad.
What?
It made me so sad.
It made you sad. Yeah. What about when they got back together? Yeah. That's where it all plays out. Going from one state to another. Going from the good enough is when it sort of has something like sadness, and then it gets better. And then it goes back, it gets better, right? And then the ugly is when you can't get back if you just stayed sad all the time. So Jerry Bruner said, and Jerry Bruner was someone who taught both Barry Brazelton and myself, that all humans, infants, children, and adults, constantly try to make a coherent and complex meaning of their sense of self in the world. It is what we do. We try to make it more coherent, we try to make it more complex, and we try to get a sense of how we relate to the world. For mothers of toddlers, you know, a 30-month-old, it's actually something they often experience, like when they'd like to go to the bathroom alone, or they're on the phone, or whatever. You know, now that we have this wonderful world of Skype, and I Skype my grandson, and I start, you know, talking with my daughter, and, you know, my grandson is in the background, you know, just getting her attention. And as soon as he gets her attention, he couldn't care less, right? It's just, you have to. So I don't just mean to make light of it. It does have an effect on the parents. It's actually, we're beginning to study some of those effects that it does have on the parents, because I think with parents who are under a lot of stress, when situations like this happen, not they're doing the still face, but for whatever reason, and the child starts to get disorganized, it leads to their own disorganization, and then you set up an interactive pattern that's problematic. So we're starting to do some studies where we're looking more at the mother's side in terms of the effect of the still face on her organization rather than just on the infants. Probably not everyone heard that, but with a parent who has a child who does not interact, because the child is playing a really active role. When we first did this experiment, it was to show that the infant was actually doing something in the interaction, that the infant wasn't just passive. You could give my talk. I can see you saying the words, right? But that the infant isn't passive in this. And we have done experiments with adults where we've asked one adult to role play the mother or the adult, and one person to role play the infant. And they don't have to, the person role playing the infant doesn't have to act like a baby. They just have to put their mind into being an infant. And there's no deception in this. So the two people, like Judy right here, is hearing what I'm telling the other person to do. And what happens is you get a still face effect. The adult who's not responding starts to feel anxious and guilty and like they're doing something really wrong. And the person who's playing the infant starts to feel things like feeling panicky and nervous and frenzied. It's like when you travel and people aren't speaking your language and they just think if they just say it louder, you'll get it. Well, you know, that's exactly what that little boy does. And it's what people were feeling. And something we were not prepared for in those studies was that when the study was over, and again, I want to emphasize there was no deception here, the adults, probably about a third of them, apologized to the person who was playing the infant. You know, like, I'm sorry, he made me do it. You know, I felt really bad. But, you know, I think it speaks to, it's not cognitive knowledge. They know it's an experiment, right? You know, they're at a university and they know there's no deception. And yet in your body, you feel this. And I think that's what the infants are doing, because the infants, not the 30-month-old, but the 10-month-old and the 6-month-olds that we study, don't have symbols, don't have language, but they're reacting with all the other kinds of meaning-making systems that they have. So if we talk about age possible meanings, starting with the newborn, the infant has all sorts of communications about what's going on. Someone was saying they were thinking of having Kevin Nugent out here to teach the neonatal behavioral observation scheme. I mean, Bill, right? You know, a really key part of that is to learn these kinds of signals and communications. They're not just signals, but communications from the infant. And I don't know if some of you have had NCAS training. Has anyone had nursing, right? Probably half of it has to do with these kinds of interactions and behaviors. And then you have an infant with Barry Brazelton. So, you know, what could be better? Barry sticking out his tongue at this baby. And this is newborn or neonatal imitation, something that people thought was absolutely impossible. And then a number of researchers have done it. It's not easy to get, but here's Barry doing it. But what I think is the most remarkable piece of this, well, actually, there's two. There's one in this picture, which is, you notice how Barry is holding the baby's arm and the baby's head, really getting it focused. He's doing it so that these other behaviors, like reaching or startles or whatever, aren't happening on the part of the infant. And then the infant, and we, by the way, we know infants can't reach newborns. They can't do it. And then the infant reaches up towards the face. And if you remember in the 11-month-old in the still face, what does she do? She reaches out at some point, like, pick me up. What are you doing? What's going on here? This is another kind of communication gesture. And notice how the hands are open and they're in an open kind of gestural sort of posture. So not only is the baby imitating, but the baby is saying, okay, well, there's something also I want to do in this situation. I want to show you this sequence of events. This is actually a mother who is from Amherst. So if any of you recognize her, there's nothing not to recognize. I'd love to know, you know, like any of the gossip you have. and her son, who's 6 months old, weighs 22 pounds. So this is a hefty little kid. And he is having the best time. I can only wish you to have times like this. You know, she's leaning in, he's grabbing her hair. He's just happy. Like, let's continue this forever, right? And then after a while, she starts to feel like it's a bit too much. So she starts to disengage from him. And then she makes this facial expression when she finally gets his hands out of her hair, which is kind of angry facial expression. In chimpanzees, it's called a bare tooth grin. And I love that it's like, I'm going to show you my teeth, but I'm grinning, right? Sort of like the Joker in Batman. So she makes this facial expression. And notice how he's changed from that very first slide, right? His hands are frozen in space. His posture is straight up. He's looking straight at her. His facial expression has changed. And I want to show you the contrast between these two. She's making this facial expression. A few hundredths of a second later, he's putting his hands in front of his face, right? She's already changed. She's already detected something problematic has gone on. And she's doing something which is a blowing game that they do together that we've seen in other interactions. When we first looked at this tape, we could not explain what the baby was doing with its hands in front of its face. So mother's facial expression lasts less than a third of a second. And we thought that the reason he put his hands in front of his face was because of the blowing game, that she blew in his face and he put his hands up in front of it. And, you know, this is the kind of craziness we engage in. So we did slow motion, and this blowing occurs afterwards, and his responses to her facial expression. So he puts his hands up in front of his face. She's now doing something else, and notice how her facial expression not only has changed, but there's a sort of concern or sadness or whatever you'd like to see. And he's more defended. And then she starts tapping along his leg. Her facial expression is changing. And what is he doing? It's the cutest thing in the world, right? He looks out from under his hands to see, like, is this about to happen again? What's going on here, right? And then she starts to play, he starts to play. But it takes him almost another 30 seconds after they start to play to actually look at her, to come back and look at her. So they're smiling and it looks like it's repaired, but it's not fully repaired. So the question is, what is the meaning that he's making of this? I'll just do the slides quickly, right? Remember we used to have flip cards? World's changed. What do I think is going on? Whatever it means for an infant to experience this facial expression on the part of the mother as being threatening or something like it's dangerous or whatever. When I show you all these pictures about the meanings that infants are making, we don't know, certainly I don't know, really what kind of meaning that they're making. But we know across a whole range of species that when you do something threatening, they respond defensively. And they respond to the threat not as something interesting. After all, that facial expression could be just interesting to the baby, could make him laugh, it could be whatever. But what he does, he responds as if something threatening is about to happen. And then in the context of it being his mother and her changing, he begins to peek out and he reestablishes contact, and he starts to smile, and then they play together. And she picks up on it as quickly as he does, because as soon as he reacts this way, she's changing within several hundred seconds, parts of a second, you know, to what he's doing. So when things like this happen, he has a way of organizing himself in an attempt to be safe. When they repair the interaction, they have a new way of being together. They've experienced something, and now they've figured out some way to get back together. They figured out a new way to change what's going on. She figured out the blowing game didn't work, I'll try this. He's playing with, let's see, how should I get back to her? I'm gonna sort of be disengaged from her. One of the messages that I think he gets out of their ability to repair the interaction is that he can trust the partner to repair the interaction. And they make new forms of a meaning, because here's a whole experience which, although I don't know, I expect this little boy hasn't had before. It's not what the mother typically does with him. And they now have something new about what's going on between them and in the world for them to think about. So these meanings are expressed in the moment to moment. Her facial expression lasts less than a third of a second. He reacts in less than a third of a second. She's already reacting before he finishes his reaction. And then they go back and forth, playing it out over time. So let's see what happens when there's a failure to make meaning. We used to have this idealized characterization of quote unquote normal interactions. And the model that we use, you can read this, but the model that we use was Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. We were all very impressed. We were really impressed that babies and mothers could interact with each other at all. And so we went overboard and we compared them to Fred and Ginger, you know, making the baby, of course, Ginger, because she had to dance backwards in high heels, right? And they never made a mistake. And so we began to think that the really good, the really normal interaction is one that has more and more synchrony in it, right? And we forgot about the fact that, you know, they didn't just start dancing with one another. They rehearsed a lot. And they had film clips to cut out the bad parts, right? But somehow we, the researchers, tended to forget about that. So in the research that we've done, what we found is that the dancing is more like the dancing, at least, that I do. And since research is only about yourself, my dancing is not very good. I try not to step on my wife's toes. We often do it, or I often do it. And then when we recover and get back in synchrony, it feels really good again, right? Now, some of you may dance really well. But we try not to have mismatches or errors that are too severe or too significant, right? You try not to step really hard on your partner's toes, and you try to recover, and then you feel good about when it's happening. So you're together part of the time, and you're not together part of the time. So the model that we've developed is this idea that there's a period of time where there's a matching of meaning that's going on. In the mother who makes the angry face, when she's first leaning in and playing with the baby, she's probably as happy as he is, right? You would hear them laughing and whatever while this was going on, right? But then when she decides to pull away, there's a mismatch of the meanings. He wants to hold on, and that's what generates her angry face and vocalization about it. So he has an intention to continue. She has an intention, which is, this is sort of enough. So they mismatch, they misstep with one another, and then they engage in a process of reparation. And the typical interaction is like that. It's synchronous for short periods of time, it's mismatched, it's synchronous again, and it goes through over time, this process of matching, reparation, mismatching, reparation. And that's what the typical interaction is. We don't see, in fact, most of the time is spent in mismatching states with infants, about 70% of the time in our research. And since we're really good researchers, that's absolutely true. Yes? If this continues, I think in this cycle, it does establish trust, right? And I think it characterizes all interactions. I don't think it's just true about infants. I think it's true about adults. So in that sense, it is infinite and keeps on going, at least till we all stop. Because if going to the point of trust, I think one of the things that happens in adult interactions, if you think about I saw a friend today who I hadn't seen for a while who lives here in Whately. This is someone I've known for years, really trust him. And if you start to think about those friendships and intimate relations that you have, which are really the strongest ones that you have, they're certainly the ones where you have more fun and you're in sync and all sorts of things like that. But one of the really critical things, especially in potentially contentious relationships, like partnerships, right, is that you get into fights. Probably a really critical thing about what makes relationships really solid is that you both come into the situation knowing that you're most likely to be able to repair what's going on, no matter how bad the fight is. And I know none of you fight with your partners, and I certainly never fight with my wife, but it is really good to know that we can repair it. And the ones that are most problematic are the ones where you don't feel they do get resolved. So I think this process is a really general kind of process. But what happens, let's start, when there's chronic or reiterated failure to repair? This sort of cartoon tries to capture that, where the mismatching goes on for a long period of time. But you can begin to think of the still face as this prolonged mismatch, right? And what you can begin to think of is what happens when those mismatches last for a really long time and you don't get reparation. One of the areas that we've looked at this is in mothers who have postpartum depression. So for example, the study that we did was we looked at infants of mothers who had depression, and we then had one of our research assistants be the stranger. And they've seen hundreds of babies. They played with lots of babies. And they don't know what group this infant comes from. And there are a whole bunch of effects, but they're really very dramatic. And Tiffany Field and Beatrice Beebe have now seen the same kind of thing, where the stranger starts out sort of with their normal interaction, normal greeting to the infant. And then her animation starts to go away. And what she then does is she she moves back. So she increases her distance from the infant. Now that's often one of the ways you can get infants to respond to you, which is not being the grandparent effect, like, aren't you fabulous, aren't you fabulous, right? Sometimes it's good to leave them at a little distance. Stranger moves further back and touches the baby less. So without coding anything about the baby, we could look at how our strangers, quote unquote, our research assistants, were interacting with the infant and see what was going on. Right? because they're reading the signals that they're getting from the infant, right? So the infant is now having, is bringing the history that they have into the situation. So it's really problematic because getting it in a way from sort of both sides, and part of the long-term dynamics of it is, of course, that if that continues, then it means that the infant, now child, comes into other situations where they, it's hard to find the right word, but they generate a situation where the other person no longer is an effective interactant, even though they might be, right? And of course, you know, what that adult ends up doing is either blaming the child or being really confused about, why isn't this working? What am I doing wrong? Or what is the child doing wrong? It sort of brings out potentially lots of the biases that one may have. So it's really, it's an important question, but it has to do with the developmental consequences that are starting really very early. So the importance of screening for depression, the importance of screening for all sorts of things, and trying to prevent those kinds of vicious patterns from getting set up is really critical. So it's another reason why we need, you know, things done early and quickly. So let me go through these: failure of reparation, the idea that the sense that the infant can't control their own feelings, the feeling that we can't control things in a particular kind of way. That infant that we saw may have some intention to be playful and happy, and yet we're not able to do that together. I think the other thing that happens, and we see it a lot in adult patients, and I think it's something that comes out of not only their early experience, but it comes out of the experience that they have over time growing up, is that they begin to get stuck in their own feelings. So they have the feeling they generated in other people, and they get back that same feeling. So they feel sad, they interact sadly, they get sadness back. And after a while, they don't find a way to overcome or change that. And certainly a big meaning is, I have no place in the world because I'm not able to be effective in the world. But what we do know, this is one of Harlow's monkeys, is that when there's deprivation, right, which is what we call the deprivation and neglect, you get this kind of failure. And what's happening is that these animals, and then these animals, because they're not getting support from the outside, because they're not successfully making meanings together, that they have to take care of themselves, that they have to, in more technical terms, they have to self-regulate. They have to control their own systems, right? Because they're getting disrupted out here, so the thing that they have to do is turn inward and control it, and try to maintain whatever coherence that they have. But there's really a huge cost to it. And while we talked about that for a long time in terms of maternal deprivation or deprivation of stimulation, I think what the underlying problem is that they have these chronic periods of time in which they're not successfully making meaning, they're not matching the meanings that are going on. They can't grow their mind except in a direction which says, I have to take care of myself. This is one of, someone mentioned Yale, this is one of the babies from Sally Province's studies. A failure to thrive, but it was not because of a lack of nutrition. And this is a baby who, a child who was in a Romanian orphanage. So if we go to matching, if we go to the normal process or the more typical process, you have matches, the repairs, you get the mismatch, and you get a quick repair, and you're going back and forth between making sense of the world, being confused, making sense of the world. So in this situation, the infant gets a sense that they can control their feelings because they're getting help in controlling their feelings. And of course, by the way, the adult is getting some of these same feelings as well. I know what to do. I can figure out what's going on here, right? The idea that we can control our feelings. And some of you who are parents may have had the experience that how, if you have more than one child, how you love them all equally, but you knew what to do with some of them better than you did with others. That you had a better sense on how we could be together than how we, meaning with another child, could be together, right? I feel connected, right? We can get back together, we can share meanings, and in that sharing of the meanings, we can feel connected. And I think this is something I alluded to before, is that the child learns that they can change their feelings. They can go from being threatened or sad or turned away, and then it can become positive. Your example, right? It made you feel sad, but then you felt happy. You know, those are simple words, but it is a non-trivial point. If you know that you can go from feeling pretty sad, pretty upset, whatever, to feeling okay and to feeling good, it's a really powerful effect. One of the things that Barry taught me was sometimes with older children, 4 and 5 year, or 3, 4, 5 year old children, getting them to reflect on how their feelings have changed over time in a situation. You know, you fell off your bike, you were really upset. Now they're feeling better. So in a way, they already know they're feeling better. But once they start to have words, you can use words to say, boy, you were really crying, and now look how you have done it. Now, he's from Texas, so it's important for him that, you know, you be the strong individual and that you change your feelings. But one of the things I see in adult clinical patients is that they have no idea that they can change their feelings. They have no way to change their feelings. And even when their feelings change, they don't believe that they'll stay changed. And so it doesn't lead to change in the way they are. They really get stuck. And the sense that their place in the world has finished. So, what does it mean, Master? This is where I don't have the answers, right? I have to tell you, this is my grandson, right? Isn't that fabulous? I mean, really. Anyway, right? What does it mean? So there has to be a balance, right? It would really be a problem. Some of the people in the audience may remember there was an psychodynamic approach which said we had to protect our children from stress. This was in the 50s and 40s, that we had to protect our children from stress because stress is what, and frustration in particular, is what makes them neurotic. There are a lot of problems with that. One is that the analyst didn't really appreciate how wonderful it is to be neurotic. Right? You know, it is what makes us interesting and different, right? But the other thing that they didn't appreciate was not only that you couldn't do that, it's just impossible to be Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers or to go through the world like Gene Kelly, you know, singing in the rain. You just can't do it all the time. The frustrations out there are inevitable. But what they really didn't appreciate was that in resolving those stresses, in finding a way to resolve them, new meanings got created, and that you actually grow and develop in doing that. So that it's not only that you'd like to prevent the frustration, but in a sense, the frustration is really necessary for the development of the system. And while we do not know the boundaries on this, right, there's a balance between how much frustration, how much matching, and how much frustration one can tolerate and how much one experiences that really leads to typical neurotic normal development. So balance is the key. Thank you. We have some time.